Okay, so here's my instruments. What we're going to be looking at is this thing here. This is my wind rose. So the red one tells me where my apparent wind is. So this is the wind direction that we actually feel on the boat. The blue one is my true wind. So this is the wind as it's being blown across the water or in relation to the land. So this is the direction of wind that you see coming on your wind maps and everything like that. This red one here is the important one for us to trim sails. This one here is important for us to know where to sail and our jibe and tack angles. So if I wanted to jibe right now, I would be jibing to 150 on the other board, so I'll have a 60 degree jibe angle to go through to maintain this same setup but on the other jibe. So this one's important in knowing where I'm going. This one, the red one, the apparent one, is important for knowing how or what to trim to, because this is what is in relation to my sails. Very, very important. Okay. Boat speed, you know, this directly affects this and this. The faster I go, the more this red one here gets dragged forward. This one here will always stay the same, provided I'm roughly heading the same angle. But if my true wind angle stays at 150 and my boat speed, say, increased to 10 knots, I would drag this apparent wind here another 20 odd degrees forward to here, just because my boat's moving faster through the air. Right, and these are actual numbers. So you can see that the red one here corresponds to my red one here, the blue one corresponds to my blue ones here, that my apparent is 120 odd degrees and it's 8 knots of apparent wind. My true wind is 150, relates to my rose, and my true wind is 13 knots. You'll see that my apparent wind is lower than my true wind, and that is because I'm moving with the wind. Because the wind is behind me and my boat's moving through the water at 7 knots, I'm actually reducing the amount of wind blowing from behind the boat. So this is a good thing going downwind. It means you can carry slightly bigger gear up downwind, and this is why we carry spinnakers and code zeros downwind. If I was going upwind, this one here, the apparent wind, will be higher than the true wind, because the wind's coming from the front and we're going into it, so there's an addition of the wind plus the boat speed, blah blah blah, and it gets really windy. Anyway, that's all we really need to see with my instruments. Here you can see there's a little wind indicator up here as well, sort of indicating that, hey, my wind indicator on top of the mast is the same as my apparent. So let's go and have a look at the sail configuration that I've got up at the moment. Right, it's a gorgeous day here. There's Ibiza. We're just crawling past the northwestern coastline, heading north off to Palma and Mallorca. Boat plodding along nicely. Now the sail configuration that I have up is my code zero, that big thing there, and my full main. Now this is actually the wrong sail configuration for this wind for me. I should actually be running my A1, which is in the bag there. But this morning it was a case of I can't be arsed hoisting it. So I hoisted the zero with the intention that when I get to the headland just there, the breeze will run forward and get a little bit windier. So I'm preparing myself for a sail change, the wind changing and having to do a sail change. So I started off with a different sail. Now, what I'm looking for with this code zero is, right, how do I get this shot? Let's do a bit of a lie down here. Okay. These things here, telltales, very, very important. Okay, you can see I've got three rows of them. Halfway, three quarters, quarter way up. You'll notice they're in the sort of the first 25% of the leading edge. And this is where all the action happens. And this is what I trim the sail to. It's a little bit difficult right now because I'm actually running too low, too deep, or too far downwind for this sail to actually be working properly. So it's all looking a little bit funky, but it's working. And I'll show you what I'm looking for with my trim. Up the top here, I have actually got enough twist in the head so you can see the sail. You can see this black stripe here is showing you the shape of my sail, and it focused to my hand and not the sail. So I've got quite a bit of knuckle in the front here because I'm running quite a loose cable at the moment. And this sort of helps to get some sort of airflow attached running really deep with this quite flat sail. And then you can see my sail shape through here, quite flat, and we're not very well attached. And we can tell that by these red telltales, which are on the opposite side of the sail, are actually hanging down. The blue ones on this side are also hanging down. So this is indicating that my sail is over trimmed and all stalled in the bottom section here. However, in the top end here, you can maybe or maybe not see that the telltales are actually wanting to fly. The red ones on the outside are actually flowing. The inside ones are actually luffing this way a little bit, so I've actually got a little bit too much twist, and you can actually see the cable is rolling in. And what's happening, particularly up the top there, because I've got so much twist, is the wind is pushing on the outside of the sail and not on the inside of the sail, and folding the sail in. And this is where you want to be trimming these downwind sails. So the A sail in particular, that is the best indication that you've got your sail trimmed about right, is that that front shoulder is folding in like this, and just flapping and snapping back. With this sail, you can actually see it doesn't actually flap and snap back, but sort of, ready, wait for it when I go over a wave. This blister appears in the sail here, and that's the luff of the sail just folding in. So this is saying, hey, actually the luff is trimmed about right up here. Definitely stalled down here, but we're okay up here. To get this to all work, I would actually change the sheeting position on my boat and put a tweaker on it. Actually, I might do that. I have the tweaker set up, so we can see if I can get this sail to actually trim properly. But this will be a pretty typical problem that people have with their zero setup, where they're stalled in the bottom, twisted open, too open in the head, flapping at the top and not drawing properly, and somewhere in the middle it's actually drawing and working right. Now, have a look at our mainsail. This thing, because we're running 120 degrees of apparent wind, that means that the wind is coming from, okay, there's my dagger boards, there's my mast. My dagger boards are almost 90 degrees to my mast just behind it, but let's call it 90 degrees. So the wind at 90 degrees is straight out the side of the boat. The wind is aft of that, so it's coming from my back corner here. So for it to actually flow around the mast and the mainsail is nigh impossible unless I've got my code zero or the spinnaker to turn the breeze around. So it's my big code zero is catching the wind here and turning the wind around so that it'll actually attach to the main a little bit. And you'll see I've got little pinky red telltales up here flapping around. Whee! All right. Aim of the game here is to actually have them flowing and streaming backwards. And that means that there'll be actually some sort of airflow attached to this back side of the sail here. Now it's really, really difficult to get, this is quite a flat main, to get things to attach when you're trying to run really deep like what I am at the moment. So this is a difficult point of sail for my boat. My boat likes slightly higher apparent wind angle, so breeze a little bit further forward. So for me to run deep like this, particularly with this zero, it's not the best setup. And hopefully when we get around the corner of the island, we can show you a bit better setup. But we're showing you what's not ideal to start with. You can also see that I've got quite a bit of twist in the main, and I'll go down the back of the boat and we'll look up the main and up the leech and we'll see the twist. So what that means is the head of the sail is actually twisting open and out like this to get these telltales up here to flow, okay? And yeah, all right, let's go to the back of the bus and have a look up the main, show you what we're looking for there. Okay, so we're at the back of the bus, a little bit quieter back here. Gonna have a look up at our boom. So we've got the main sheet here, we've got the mainsail there. Right, I'm gonna move again. So you can see things flapping and wiggling and wobbling around a bit. So you can see the main is sort of dancing. So the leech goes from straight to twisted to straight to twisted to straight. What we're trying to maintain is slightly twisted leech profile. Hang on. Now we can see how much twist I've got in the main. Right, so the twist in the main is, you follow the leech, where's my finger there? There it is, sunshine in my head. So this is the leech of the sail, this is the back edge. Okay, so where I'm sheeted on the boat is down here on the deck, at this point and that point. And these main sheet systems are shit. I hate it, hate it, hate it, hate it. Track and Traveler, way better, way easier to trim than these silly bloody setups. Anyway, another conversation altogether. So we're going from the main sheet down here. It's on a angle but angle, goes to the boom, connects to the boom through my block. It's all flapping and dancing around in the waves and the wind. Then we go into the leech. And the leech, basically I've eased the main sheet until these little tiny pink telltales here just start flowing off the back of the leech. That tells me that there is some sort of airflow attached to my mainsail. You can see my main is quite flat here. If I had telltales on here, well I do actually, but you can't see them in the camera. They're attached on the windward side, but they're definitely not attached on the leeward side. So we're stalled on the leeward side, which is pretty typical of this, but it's attached at the back end here enough to make it all flow and make things happen again. Now with this setup, if you do get caught in some breeze, what's going to pull hard is this sail here. This sail here is attached to the bowsprit on the front here and to the tippy top of the mast. When it pulls, it's pulling the rig forward. Now the side stays are swept back a little bit. So the side stays here are actually aft of the mast, so they act as a bit of a backstay, but it's not enough. So what we use as a backstay is this thing here, the main sheet. It's quite important that your main sheet is reasonably tight at all times. And this is why I don't like this setup, because with a traveler track, I'd have the track coming out here. So I'd drop traveler, a little bit more main sheet, control that twist. I'd actually have a little bit less twist. I'd have it a little bit more open in the bottom end. And because it's tighter, it would act more as a backstay, holding the back of the mast. With this much sort of twist in the bottom end, I've got to try and get the twist at the top. I haven't got much main sheet tension, and that means I haven't got much backstay action either. So this is not the best ideal situation, but if it gets windy and I get a bit nervous, I will actually just pull the main sheet on and stall it and use it as a backstay. And this is a very safe option, not to rip the rig out of your boat. but it's
it's got to get quite windy. So we've got what, 12 to 14 knots. If I had a big front come through at 20 plus, and I pooped my pants a bit, first thing I would do is I would crank on the main sheet. So I would crank on that winch there, which pulls on my main sheet, stabilize the back end of the rig, get that main sheet sorted. Then I'd run forward, grab my furler line here, and furl away the zero. That's my first course of action for getting this thing safe. And I'm not gonna rip the rig out, but yeah. So that's the first part of having a look at the sail and sail trims. Hopefully I'll get to the end of this island here shortly. Breeze has swung a bit, so I may have to jibe before I get there again. And hopefully we'll be able to harden up and we'll be able to look a little bit better at the sail trim and what this sail is actually really capable of doing, rather than sort of hanging around in this breeze. Well, the day's worn on a bit, and the breeze has not done what we'd hoped it would do. It's nicely dropped out, so we are on the A1, and we can show you how to trim this now. It's a little bit tricky because the sea state's a bit sloppy. As you can see, we have a wind speed. Oh, we're up to 6 knots now, so it might be stable. It's been hovering around that 4 knot mark for a while, so it's good. Might be able to get some good shots of the kite with this. So anyway, yeah, 4 knots of boat speed, 6 knots of wind, happy days. Now, here you'll see the sail is dragging the apparent round quite nicely, so our apparent is near 95, and the true wind is 140, so it's dragged it quite forward. Oh, there it's coming close back down again as the boat decelerated. There we go. Anyway, you can see the apparent floating around as the boat accelerates and decelerates, but the true wind is being kept around that 145-ish mark. Anyway, well, let's kind of look at the sail. So first thing you'll notice is that we've jibed. We're on the other board. We've actually jibed, I think, 3 or 4 times, and we've had the zero up and down and the A up and down, and we actually motored for about 20 minutes because there was all of 1.5 knots there for a while, and we had to get through that transition zone. Anyway, I'm going to have a look at the trim on this kite. Now you can see that shoulder is rolling and wanting to fold in. That is telling me we're right on the edge of where that needs to be trimmed. That is ideal. It's not helping because we've got a little bit of sloppy sea state here. You can see a few little waves rolling around, and that's rocking the boat around, which is encouraging this luff to flop around and roll in. But what it's telling me is my kite is trimmed just right. If it was trimmed on any tighter, the luff sits really tight, like where it is now, boned up. If the trim is too loose, the shoulder will actually roll and nearly collapse. So this shoulder will actually roll in from here all the way back in, sort of 2 or 3 panels in the kite. And sometimes it'll hold there, and that says, right, you need to trim it on some more. So we trim it on until the shoulder goes back, stands up, and it just flop, flop, flops backwards and forwards. And we know our trim is about right. Now, if we want to get into it a little bit more, you'll also notice that I've got the halyard eased a bit. And the reason for that is because it's quite light and we're running quite deep. I want the shoulder to stand out and be quite round and full, and project quite a bit. And that also gets the shoulder rolling in the right position. It will tend to roll in the middle. If I bone it up, it'll tend to roll more at the top and not at the bottom. So that's a good indication of how much luff tension you required as to where this is folding on the sail. Kids have called this sail Big A. That's our E1. What else can we note? It's really light and everything's flippity floppity flappity. Other than that, it's actually all, the sail's a bit of a glamour. Sets really well. Let's have a look at the leech profile. It's nicely twisted open, not too far off that of the mains. Probably a little bit shut down in the head there, but good enough for government work. And the main I've got on a little bit tightish at the moment because of the flapping. Little tricks like, here is the bucket pull down string. Gets a quick little half hitch on the net here. It's got a good twisty lao lao going on, but that all comes out pretty quickly and easily. That's to keep the bucket off the sail too much, otherwise the bucket tends to slide down the sail. Do need to shorten it a bit, that's a bit long. But other than that, we're very, very slowly heading to Mallorca. Okay, so we're back to the code zero, and the breeze has filled in a little bit finally. So we can see on the numbers here, we've got some reasonable boat speed. So sort of 7.3 in the water, 7.4 on GPS. The true wind speed is around 7 knots. So we're doing a good comfortable wind speed at the moment. Apparent wind is around the 8 knots. So we're generating our own wind quite nicely. And you can see here we've dragged the wind from 120 true around to 60 true. This is a little bit out because I've gone and I've rotated the mast a bit. So all of these numbers should be aft, around 15 odd degrees, but yeah, it's mast or minus. But let's go look at the trim of the kite, code zero. See how we're getting on. Better check it before I go and show you. Oh yeah, still looks all good. I'll be all humming along. Then no wind. Okay, let's go have a look. Okay, here we are. So we'll see here when we go through some waves. We can lie down and have a look up. Yeah, there you go. We just saw when we went through the wave then, as the mast pitched forward and then came back, as it pitches forward it accelerates the sail forward in the air, and you can see the blister form in this area here. There it is. And then as it decelerates, it goes tight again. So this, I know, is my trim position because I'm flipping between being oversheeted and undersheeted, depending on what little wave we go through. You can see as well now that I've got the luff tighter, so that knuckle that was in the front is now gone. It's actually quite flat in the front. We've got plenty of sag in our cable here. Funky kink here. Might have to talk to my sailmaker wife about that. But other than that, is looking pretty good. The leech is a bit flippy. Might have to give it a snip and a tuck and make that work a little better. Now here you can see what is what we consider the ideal sheeting on position for this sail at the moment, and it's obviously working quite well. So to get to this position, I sheeted on the sail so it wasn't flapping, and then I eased it out again and kept easing it out until I achieved this trim position. So I just keep easing, and then I just sort of wait and see, and until I'm happy with this. If I ease it a little bit too much, I pull it back on until I achieve what I'm looking at here. This is what we're looking for. Oh, and probably can't see it, but just in the mist there is Palmer. Finally made it after we had a really terrible spell of sitting in the doldrums with less than one knot for about 2.5-3 hours, which wasn't much fun. So I've been doing a little bit of tramp work, tramp coming nice and tight again. It's good. Cool.